Giuseppe Tarantini, I'm the chief of intervention cardiology in the University of Padua, and the trial that we are going to discuss is named Dubius. Well, on top of the very well renowned and established benefits of the new P2Y12 in the setting of acute coronary syndrome patients, there are some questions that still linger related to the optimal timing of administration of Prasugrel or Ticagrelor, especially in a non-ST elevation acute coronary syndrome patient treated invasively. Accordingly, in the last release of the ES guidelines, that's dated on August 2015, the authors stated that there is no specific recommendation on whether or not we have to go for pretreatment in this setting of patients that are non-ST elevation in this patient. And similarly, there are many doubts related to the timing of administration of these drugs because this issue has not been adequately investigated. But we have to, to say also something that the guidelines, the ES guidelines, took a stand at that time, it was 2015, in favor of the upstream, because there is a clear 2A level of evidence indication, recommendation for the upstream strategy with ticagrelor or clopidogrel when ticagrelor was not indicated, as soon as the diagnosis of non-ST elevation acute coronary syndrome has been established. This is the context and the background for the Dubius trial. That is, dubius is a Latin word that means doubt, and is the acronym of downstream versus upstream administration new P2Y12 in the setting of non-ST elevation acute coronary syndrome plan for invasive cardiology, for invasive strategy. And the aim is to, evaluate the downstream against upstream strategy in terms of 30-day safety and efficacy in the context of patients that I told you before. This was an investigator-driven, double-randomized, open-label, multi-center, and adaptive trial design that was sponsored by the Italian Society of Intervention Cardiologists and the Azienda Ospedaliera di Padova, that is a public healthcare system. And the CRO was the University of Padua. The trial is not too complicated because we have a couple of randomization. As soon as the patient has been admitted in the hospital with an acute non-ST elevation acute coronary syndrome, the patient will receive the first randomization in pretreatment, that means ticagrelor, versus non-pretreatment strategy, that means ticagrelor versus Prasugrel. At that point, only in the downstream arm, only if the patient will receive a PCI, there is a second randomization towards ticagrelor versus Prasugrel. And the primary hypothesis that was powered is the superiority of the downstream versus upstream strategy as related to the NACE, the 30-day NACE, that means the 30-day combination of major ischemic and bleeding endpoints. So as I told you before, as soon as the patient with a non-ST elevation acute coronary syndrome was admitted in the hospital, the patient was treated with aspirin and fraction heparin and received the first randomization between ticagrelor, that means upstream, and then downstream, that required the invasive assessment of coronary artery. And before, at that point, before the PCI was attempted, so we had to go for a second randomization, that means Prasugrel versus ticagrelor. So this is very important because the Dubius trial is a trial that compares strategies and not agents. And this is totally different from the ISAVAC file trial that compare agents and non-strategies. So based on that, the patients that would receive the PCI were randomized 50% in Prasugrel and 50% in ticagrelor, and we evaluated the outcome at 30 days. The inclusion criteria were quite simple and included patients with an acute coronary syndrome, no STEMI, non-ST elevation ECS patient, aged between 15 and 85 years old, that has to be planned for invasive management within 72 hours, according to the guidelines recommendation with the last release that was 2015. Related to the exclusion criteria, we excluded general exclusion criteria where chronic anticoagulation regimen at the time of the inclusion of the trial, the potential involvement in the trial, contraindication to the new potent P2Y12, the 2-ATAC-AGAR or Prasugrel, and treatments with a loading dose of any new P2Y12 or even clopidogrel within the previous week. So the main outcome, this is a very important point, because the trial foresaw a final enrollment of 2,520 patients. But as I told you before, the trial had an adaptive design. That means that we foresaw three interim analyses to look for potential arm of one treatment against the other, one strategy against the others, but also to avoid futility. That means lack of projected power during, you know, the enrollment of the trial. So actually, out of 2,500 patients, we stopped early the trial after the inclusion of about 1,450 patients because the two interim analyses were consistent for a very low event rate with a really, really small difference on clinical ground between the two strategy arms. That's what the absolute risk reduction in terms of the difference between downstream and upstream was 0.4%. It was consistent, the two interim analyses. For this reason, the writing committee decided to interrupt the trial for futility, and actually, you know, the 30-day NES rate was clinically too almost superimposed. This was the reason to stop. First of all, let's start from the age of the population that was enrolled. The mean age was 65 years old. 25% of the patients were diabetic patients and were distributed equally in the two arms. Other important point to keep in mind are the CREI score that was 122 in both arms, and the CRUSADE score was 22. So the patients were at relative low risk for both ischemic and bleeding events. Related to the procedure, almost 100% of the patients both arms received coronary angiography with a mean time of 23 hours. Almost all patients received angiography within 30 hours. Related to the procedure of revascularization, the patient received 70% of PCI in both arms, 6% of CABG. And what is interesting, and this is consistent with other previous trials in this patient population, almost 25% were just treated medically, and half of them, for half of them, was not even confirmed the diagnosis of acute coronary syndrome. I think all these data are relevant to understand, you know, together with the fact that this is completely different from the previous trial, like the ACOST or ISAREC 5 trial, because almost all patients, 95% of the patients, were treated by minimal radial approach in case they received PCI. This is more than double the rate reported for the ACOST and the ISAR, where the ISAR was about 35% and 43% in the ACOST. And this is really remarkable to understand the result in terms of very early outcome. 30-day difference in MACE was 2.9% in the downstream versus 3.3% in the upstream arm of the of the trial. So the difference, the absolute risk reduction difference, was only 0.4%, and the single digit endpoints was really low, both in terms of ischemic, the mortality was about 0.4% in both arms, and the bleeding rate was 1.6%. It is 40% less than the other previous trial. This is mainly related probably to, you know, the use of radial approaches was almost 100% in both arms, and totally different from the previous trial. So the conclusion that can be drawn is the following, that is this multicenter randomized trial conducted on in a non-ST elevation acute coronary syndrome patients with planned invasive management, both a downstream treatment strategy with an oral P12 inhibitor, so it is important to keep in mind in the dubious war, Prasugrel or ticagrelor, because the trial was a comparison between strategy and not between pills, and the ticagrelor-based pretreatment strategy showed very low but similar, almost superimposed rate of the composite 30-day major ischemic and bleed events. So my opinion is that our findings suggest the unlikelihood of enhancing the efficacy of one strategy over another. So the next step for me is to rephrase the new release of the guidelines. So I'm pretty sure that, you know, the new release of the guidelines will be changed based on the dubious and these are that file, because as I told you, talking about the background of the dubious trial, so this, the stand of the 2015 guidelines release was in favor of the upstream strategy as soon as the diagnosis of non-ST elevation ACS syndrome was performed, was done in the patient. I think based on the result of these two trials, this sentence is to be rephrased as following, that in patients with non-ST elevation ACS, plan for invasive strategy, the downstream strategy seems to be safe during the very early phase based on the dubious results, and the downstream with Prasugrel based on the ESO-REACT 5 seems to be superior to the upstream strategy with ticagrelor at 1 year follow-up. And I think this is an opposite view of the recommendation compared to the 2015 release of the S guidelines.